Hi, everybody. Welcome to Reserve Seating. We are back with a very special episode and a very special guest, Patrick Bromley. How you doing, buddy?
Hi guys, thanks for having me back.
So last year we did a round of episodes where we were talking about movies that Gene Siskel panned that he didn't like, and the whole bit was, we'll watch them and we're going to see if we agree with Gene's review. But then this year we decided to look at movies that Gene Siskel liked, either gave like 3 stars or above. So we're going to start, let's go chronological order
Okay.
with Patrick's pick. Patrick, what was your pick?
I picked David Mamet's House of Games, the first movie that he wrote and directed.
So Gene Siskel had this as his flick of the week. And he says, clever house, a delightful fooler. Our flick of the week is House of Games, a solid directing debut by playwright David Mamet. His script involves a woman psychiatrist, played by Lindsay Krause, who is unaware of her dark secrets until she hooks up with a bunch of con artists led by love interest Joe Mantegna, who serves as both her and our tutor into the work of the scam and the mark. It's an exceedingly clever script that will fool you and delight you, sort of the sting for and about adults, which the sting is kind of about adults, so I don't really get that, but okay. Both Mantegna and Krause deserve Oscar consideration. His character is more than slick. He's slick, thoughtful, and complex, and she is very convincing playing a character who doesn't know how complex she really is. Save for a questionable ending, it's one of the year's best films.
I might like it even more than Gene's review because he's using words like
Fooler.
clever and fooler.
And the
And
sting.
to me, it makes it seem like a fun romp. And I think this movie is like badass. So I recently rewatched David Mamet's Homicide. And that led me back to House of Games because I was like, I've taken Joe Mantegna for granted. I've always liked him, but I've never been like, oh, he's literally one of the best to ever do it. And so I went back to House of Games, and I might like House of Games even more than Homicide, just because Homicide's probably a better movie. House of Games is like more my speed. And I'm just a big David Mamet fan in terms of movies. Like, I won't pretend to know his theatrical work as much as a lot of people do. I mean, I've seen Glengarry Glen Ross. Does that count? But like, I really like his movies, and I think this is one of the best parts Joe Mantegna has ever had. I like movies about con artists. I like movies about cons, including fanboys. No, that's not about a con. And this is, I think, one of the very best. I know Gene references The Sting, but I would put this kind of right up there. The Sting is more of like, this is like the down and dirty version of The Sting, but it's equally awesome.
This was my like second or third time watching this, and I do love David Mamet. I took a really great like American Playwrights class in college and really got to know Mamet's work really well. So I guess I'm kind of straddling both lines. This feels very much like a Mamet play. It feels like you could easily lay this out. I imagine like I was trying to think of this what the staging would be if you were just do this as like a play. And I was thinking of the table in the early act where the initial poker game happens. And I kind of had in my head different sort of set pieces of what a sort of fixed stage performance of this would look like. And I think you could probably do it. You talked about Mantegna, and Adam and I have a Joe Mantegna related surprise. I think we might reveal at the end of this episode, maybe. I'm not sure. We might. As you said, I think this is one of the best deployments of him because Mantegna, and I'm speaking for myself here, I frequently see when I see Joe Mantegna in the cast, I think, well, they couldn't get De Niro, they couldn't get Harvey Keitel, like they couldn't get one of those other A-listers in that vein. But this is one of those roles that really makes you appreciate what he specifically brings that a lot of those other guys can't.
Yeah, I'm a big fan of it too. I think this was the second time I'd seen it. I wondered at first if I was going to like it as much or if it was a one and done for me because I was thinking like, oh, well, the whole thing is a con because it's a con artist movie and stuff. But then there's like an additional layer to it in the last act, which I think helps the movie have like a repeat ability that otherwise it might not have. Forgot, I think it was Tarantino talking about Jackie Brown, where it's like the first time you watch it and you're following the plot, and then once you know the plot, then it becomes a hangout movie. And I think House of Games the second time becomes that hangout movie where you like just enjoy the rhythms of the conversations and how weird Lindsay Krause is, but in a fascinating way. And it works for the character for sure, because she's supposed to be this kind of unknowable, like kind of sociopath. And she's Michael Myers is what I'm trying to say. Me and Rob have featured Joe Mantegna movies several times that we've noticed on reserved seating. So there was like a kernel of us being like Mantegna super fans. And we're putting our money where our mouth is, because what Rob alluded to is that November, keep that in, November, it's going to be Joe Mantegna month, and we're going to watch 4 Joe Mantegna movies. And Patrick, we would love to have you back for one or more of those.
Of course, thank you.
That's not even the surprise. The surprise that Rob alluded to was that throughout all of reserved seating, I've been a puppet operated by Joe Mantegna. So
here he is.
Joe, take it away.
Bring him out.
I think this is number 2 for me in terms of the Mammoth movies after Glengarry Glen Ross. Our second movie is 1995's First Night, directed by Jerry Zucker, starring Sean Connery, Richard Gere, and Julia Ormond. Gene's review was, lovely Julia Ormond, displaying more depth than in her film debut in Legends of the Fall, stars as Guinevere, who must choose between a certain life of grace with King Arthur, played by Sean Connery, and a more daring romance with the mysterious Lancelot, played by Richard Gere. Some chicks have all the luck. Actually, the film survives mostly on the strength of its casting. There isn't a combination among these three that isn't compelling. And director Jerry Zucker of Ghost surprises us by delaying the confrontation between the two men until well after we expect it, giving the film more tension than we might expect. 3 stars. I'd never seen First Night. I always wanted to see First Night, but not that bad, apparently. But I finally watched it, and it's like a 2.5 star out of 4 movie for me.
It's the definition of a 2.5 star movie.
Yeah. I mean, like, I love all the effort that went into it. Like, Camelot is really pretty. And I like that it feels lived in and not, because this is still the time of production design and sets. And Ebert actually had in his review something that was really funny. He said that either Camelot has the most candles of anywhere in the world, or that the set designer went too crazy. I don't know. I liked Connery's kind of soft and cuddly performance. We don't always get that from him. I think he does it very well. Gere is so modern that he seems like an actor playing Lancelot, as opposed to, I think, Connery, who kind of feels more authentic. And Julia Ormond, I don't have that much history with it, except just kind of knowing that she was like the it girl of that moment in 95 with Legends of the Fall and Sabrina. But yeah, I don't know. I like romances. It's romantic enough. The action's fine. It's cool seeing like Ralph Ineson and like Rob Brydon in early performances. It's very okay.
I think the movie has a Ben Cross problem. Nothing against Ben Cross, but I just think your main cast is so stacked that I think you need a villain who's sort of up to that level. It's such a 2.5 star movie, and I have nothing against Julia Ormond, and actually in later movies I would sort of come to like Julia Ormond, but like in 95 she's in 3 movies. She must have had the best agent in Hollywood, because in 95 she's in 3 movies that don't just position her as the female lead. They position her as like, this woman is Helen of Troy. This is a woman that all men would die and kill for. And I don't think she's up to it. I just think she's maybe still too inexperienced. So I think the movie also has a little bit of a Guinevere problem. It's so fine.
He probably gave 1 star each to the 3 guys who fell down that hole. Because once I saw the guy fall down the hole the first time, I'm like, well, that looked cool. I wouldn't mind seeing another guy fall down the hole, and they're like, well, here's
Don't
two more.
worry.
Like,
2.5 stars is about right, I think. I think that the movie, I think dramatically the movie falls apart when it takes the choice away from Julia Ormond and just says, like, never mind, you won't have to choose. It'll all be fine. So from a dramatic perspective, I'm thinking like, oh, this movie's kind of bullshit. It doesn't even really pay off the thing that it. I think the gear, I don't know that I'm a gear guy. I don't know that I'm, at least it's not as much as like, just to me, Kevin Costner occupies this space. And obviously there's, this movie has a lot of Robin Hood, you know, Prince of Thieves DNA in it, and probably riding that wave of sort of medieval romances. Again, dramatically, I think the movie's kind of bullshit, but I can watch the movie and see the set design. As you said, the production design is great, and there's some charm to it. So yeah, 2.5 star movie.
He runs the gauntlet to Sean Cuckery. I had to. I already told Patrick that. But all right, so our last movie is Rob's pick, and it is Peter Weir's The Truman Show. So what Gene said about that movie was, Jim Carrey gives a tour de force performance as an innocent man whose life since birth has been documented and broadcast 24 hours a day to a nationwide audience. This thoughtful, most original film, directed by Peter Weir, does nothing less than remind us of the joyous and painful chapters that comprise any individual life. 4 stars. So I kind of agree with his review while also not viewing the movie the same way that he does, I guess. I don't ever think of it as like chronicling the quirks and joys of life. I always kind of just think of it as kind of a satire on like reality TV.
So I like this movie. I hadn't seen it since I saw it, probably. I don't know that I've rewatched it in a year since. I think this movie would be more interesting without Jim Carrey. And I say that because I think this movie is 1 hour and 40 minutes when it should be 2 hours. And I think there is an opportunity there to not have to make this movie with the Jim Carrey in 1998 of it in mind. Now, I understand there's a sort of a metatext to that, which is Jim Carrey in 1998 is exactly the person who should be playing this role because he is on all of our screens. And this is exactly, I understand why you put Jim Carrey in this movie. I think this movie is very good, and it could have been really great if the connective tissue between a lot of the character arcs, the places the characters end up versus where they begin story-wise, I do not feel they are as motivated or seated by the time we get to the end of the movie as they could have been. And I'm wondering if a lot of that was take out as much of that as you can, get this down to 100 minutes because we have a Jim Carrey audience who needs their fix. I mean, the last scene is brilliant. I mean, the fact that it's just like, what else is on, you know? All that is great. I would have liked to have seen a little bit more of that shift from Gawker to sympathy played out more over the course. I would like to have pulled at those threads a little bit more.
I'm so sorry I messed up and I watched, what is it, Ed TV. I really like this movie. I've become more of a Peter Weir fan in the 26 years since this movie came out, so I appreciate it on a whole new level, but I also, it's harder to be like blown away by it because it has just become the world that we live in, if that makes sense. It's like watching Network now, where you're just like, yeah, that's TV. So it's hard to be like, wow, this movie's saying something.
There are people who would kill to be Truman.
Right. I kind of like the Jim Carrey of it all, and I appreciate, you know, I think at the time it was just like, hey, come see Jim Carrey act, which I think he does a good job of it. And like you said, I think there's a version of this movie that doesn't even get made without the Jim Carrey participation of it. Yeah, I think I was expecting to be blown away by it in a way that I wasn't even in 98 when I really liked it and probably put it on my top 10. And I think I'm a little bit with Rob where I'm just like, oh, this movie's very good, maybe not great.
I think I like it more now. I watched it once last year and then this year for reserve seating. I think I like it more now than I did in 98, and I really liked it in 98. But I think that the the runtime almost works in its favor because it makes this movie that could seem very arch and pretentious into sort of like this kind of
breezy,
more like humble type of thing, even in its length, where it's like it goes down easy because it's more casual in its brilliance, if you will. But
kind of a fooler.
Yeah.
Bit of a fooler. It's sort of like a twist on nature versus nurture, because like the whole thing is set up as this world where you would think that he's influenced by nature, by the environment that he's in, where everybody's kind of just acting off of him. And it's not a nurture thing because it's not really about how his parents raised him, but it's more like nature versus like what's ingrained in your DNA, like as far as like who you are as a person. And that sort of is willing out. And I think that's really interesting. It's sort of like, it's not as good as It's a Wonderful Life, but it's sort of like Jimmy Stewart rebelling against Bedford Falls and like having to make a choice of like, is life wonderful in, you know, all that I know, or is life wonderful in exploring the world and things like that. I think the casting is right, because if it were like Tom Hanks in it, it would just be too much of like a do-gooder type of thing, or the noble man. And I think Jim Carrey has like his little Jim Carrey quirks or flourishes are sort of like, yeah, he's kind of going nuts. He's kind of like a crazy person, like, but also a good man. So I don't know. I'm really in the bag for this one. I like it a lot. All right. Well, thank you both. This was great. Really enjoyed our conversation. Before we wrap up, each of you rank from favorite to least favorite these three movies.
Patrick.
House of Games, Truman Show, First Night.
Me too.
I would go Truman Show, House of Games, First Night.
Wow. All right.
All right.
Turns out we need to pick three First Nights next time, because too much to say about Truman Show and House of Games.
We'll be back next week. We're doing a themed month, kind of a variation of a column that I once wrote called Best Summer Ever, but this is going to be Best September Ever. And we are going to continue our celebration from F This Movie Fest of the films of 1994. We're going to talk about four movies from September 1994, starting with Quiz Show with special guest Mike Pomero. Thank you again, Patrick, for joining us.
Thank you guys so much.
And until next time.
In case I don't see you, good afternoon, good evening, and good night.
Holy shit, that was perfect.